Welcome back, everyone. I am the Executioner. And today we're taking a look at a video by the Gravel Institute. What is the Gravel Institute? The Gravel Institute was founded in response to PragerU. Essentially, it's a leftist think tank that makes as bad propaganda as PragerU. Well, I will give PragerU some credit. They've done some good takes in the past, but Gravel, you go through all their videos and realize it's all one big hot take.
In a lot of ways, America is a strangely right-wing country.
Right-wing. How's a massive bureaucracy, welfare, and surveillance state exclusively right-wing? Also, why do you characterize America as right-wing? What type of right-wing are we talking about? Goose-steppers or neoconservative? In fact, right-wing and the left-wing are false dichotomies. For New Liberty by Murray Rothbard goes into the history of the left and how it originated in the Enlightenment. Spoiler alert, it didn't begin with socialism, and it definitely didn't begin with communism. In fact, the ideas of the left predate with Adam Smith and other contemporaries. We have them to thank for the original left. Nowadays, you would characterize them as conservative. The left as we know it originated long after the fact, in the mid-19th century, when socialists and communists commandeered the term. In fact, capitalism and free markets were inherently left-wing ideas.
No universal health care, no universal child care, poor labor protections.
Poor labor protections, well, that's a blatant lie. In 2019, the number of injuries at work, counting full-time, was 2.8 per 100 workers. In 1972, that number was 10.9 workers. That was a decrease of 74%. The number of deaths from workplace injury, 6,217 in 1992, that had dropped to 5,333 deaths in 2019. By gender, in 2003, 5,129 men died at the workplace, and 446 women as well died. The first number had dropped to 4,896 in 2019, and for women, it was 437 deaths. OSHA is so proud of the 2.8 worker statistic, it's on their website. OSHA regulations are quite strict, and violations can lead to thousands of dollars of fines or tens of thousands of dollars in fines. From a person that works around heavy equipment on the daily, workers' safety is not taken lightly in the States. There are exceptions, but most employers I have worked for take it seriously. The worst countries for workers are Sierra Leone, Gambia, Myanmar, Liberia, and Uganda. In Gambia alone, 64% of workers reported a serious work-related injury. In Sierra Leone, it was about 69%.
Everyone knows this. But why is that? Well, if you look at American history, you actually find a pretty interesting reason. Unlike other industrialized countries, America never really had a powerful socialist movement.
There was a socialist movement in the United States. A pretty sizable one, I may add. In 1901, three political parties formed the Socialist Party of America. It was popular among progressives, which also was a huge movement. Both movements had policies nearly identical: minimum wage, public schooling, labor laws, and cronyist unions. The socialist movement in the United States led to Eugene V. Debs being on the party's ticket for both the 1912 and 1920 election. He garnered 913,000 votes, coming in at third place in the 1920 election. He beat the Farmer Labor Party by a considerable margin. He blew William Wesley Cox out of the water, with Wesley only garnering 31,084 votes. Three socialist political parties ran for presidential office. Combined, its grand total of votes was 1,209,482 votes. That is a staggering amount for a political movement which came in third place.
Compare that to Europe. In the 19th and 20th centuries, every country in Europe saw a huge socialist party develop. The Social Democratic Party in Germany, the Labour Party in the United Kingdom, the Socialist Party in Belgium.
First of all, you're talking about a number of decades of political philosophy and evolution. The SDP had been around since 1863, and it was one of the first Marxist-influenced parties in Europe and, in fact, the world. The Labour Party was an evolution of the Independent Labour Party in 1893. The Labour Party, as we know it, was founded in 1900. The party itself is center-left. It was, and still is today, socially democratic and historically Christian socialist. The Belgians Worker Party in 1885, may I add, was at the first meeting of the original Internationale in the drafting of the Communist Manifesto. These free political parties spanned 37 years in their history. The United States' first socialist party was the Socialist Labor Party of America. These three political parties span 37 years in their history. The United States' first socialist party was the Socialist Labor Party of America. There were, in a period from 1910 to 1956, 70 socialist mayors in the United States. Victor L. Berger, who was the subject of a very famous Supreme Court case, represented the 5th District of Wisconsin in the House of Representatives. He was an original founding member of the Social Democratic Party of America. He wasn't a one-off either. He gained re-election and won 3 more consecutive terms.
In countries like Denmark, Norway, and Sweden, parties with socialist roots governed for decades.
Scandinavia is not socialist. In academic terms, it is a mixed economy. The United States is a mixed economy. Scandinavian countries may have social safety nets. However, they rank high on the Economic Freedom Index. Some Scandinavian countries don't even have minimum wage. It's been replaced with collective bargaining through voluntary union. How many times do we need to go over this? Forbes, Mises, and Fee, and 99 other critiques have debunked this to death.
Now, none of these countries ever became fully socialist. Instead, socialist parties and their allies built well-functioning social democratic institutions. It's what they called the European way. Universal healthcare, generous welfare programs, free education, and strong protections for labor.
For fuck's sake, it's called the Nordic model. I learned this in high school economics, for God's sake. Let's take a look at countries that attempted social democracy. Venezuela under Chavez. How many times did we hear from Richard Wolff back in the day just fellate Hugo Chavez about how wonderful Venezuela was? A model of social democracy, universal healthcare, education, and other great things socialists love. Wolf then recognized it had become a failed state. However, he wouldn't admit to his faults. He denied it up and down a blue streak. It was now state capitalist, according to him. Yeah, really. When Bolivia fails due to their social democracy, he'll probably deny that as well. He'll call it, I don't know, state capitalist or crony capitalist or whatever the hell Wolf is calling it nowadays. India tried socialist-like policies as well, price controls, restricting imports, and a huge nationalization spirit. The country suffered disaster after disaster, made worse by socialist-like policy. It took until the 1980s for the country to finally get back on track. The United Kingdom owned a number of state firms and imposed heavy taxes following World War II and had economic stagnation. It only took until the 1980s, like India, to abandon its policy of socialist-leaning policy. Israel, for the first decades of its existence, had a huge socialist following. For the first years of its history, farming collectives dominated Israeli farming, the General Federation of Labor advocating controlling the means of production. The Labor Party of Israel dominated Israeli politics for two decades. It was only until the end of the Yom Kippur War did the ball get rolling. The effort of liberalization could finally start going down the hill, in small part to Dr. Milton Friedman. The problem is you're trying to combine socialist-like policy with democracy. Yet, as Milton Friedman put it in Capitalism and Freedom, intentions do not sometimes equal the desired result.
But that sort of transformation never happened in the United States. Now, to be fair, the US did see a fairly strong progressive movement in the late 19th and early 20th centuries. There was the Working Man's Party of the 1870s, the governments of radical reconstruction, which W.E.B. Du Bois called dictatorships of the proletariat, and the leftist Populist Party, which won five states in 1892. There were even two members of the Socialist Party elected to Congress.
So you were listening. How many bucks do you want to bet she's going to make up some reason to say that was in a large movement, ignoring the party she mentioned in the progressive era? I'll indulge her. Why didn't America adopt socialism?
And in 1912, Eugene Debs, the socialist presidential candidate, received a full 6% of the national popular vote. The American socialists were successful enough that in 1906, the leader of the German Social Democratic Party predicted that Americans will be the first to usher in a socialist republic. So why did the American left never gain power like the European left?
Is she ignoring the left did gain power? Woodrow Wilson, Hoover, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, Lyndon B. Johnson? Four of those presidents leaned heavily in the direction of socialism?
There are a few schools of thought about this. The most famous view, that of the German economist Werner Sombart, suggests that Americans were too prosperous and wealthy to believe in socialism. All socialist utopias, he said, came to nothing on roast beef and apple pie.
Socialism originated in France, with roots in the French Revolution and later Proudhon. Socialism thrives on creating contempt. Germany was a prosperous economy in the 19th century. Marx was born to a middle-class family. He couldn't hold down a job, and the jobs he did get were as a reporter, hardly toiling in the factories of London or the hot suns of the vineyards of Italy. He was privileged. He blew most of his tuition money on alcoholic beverages. Rudolf Sternmeister was a well-off doctor and businessman. Why is it when we look into the backgrounds of socialists and communists, we find people that little embody the spirit of the actual worker?
Socialism needed workers to live close together to form working class institutions. It could do that in places like Berlin or London or Paris, but not so much in sprawling America. Even as the country urbanized in the 20th century, it also suburbanized. Suburban sprawl promoted anonymity and atomization.
No. I'ma stop you there. Suburbanization started after World War II. The urbanization of the 19th and early 20th century was a huge part of the shift of labor. We went from a mostly rural society in 1800 to a country centered around coastal cities such as New York, Boston, Trenton, etc. In these cities, there were socialist movements like in Europe. The scale was smaller, but the urbanization point is moot as the U.S. centered around cities during the time period she is mentioning.
Rather than the sense of community and solidarity that socialism needs to take root, denser places like the Lower East Side of New York, at one point the most densely populated place on Earth, were hubs of socialism and radicalism of all shades. But the vast majority of places weren't like that. And the fact that there was so much land also meant that workers were constantly moving in search of better jobs. As late as the 1960s, about 20% of Americans moved every year.
How much of that is capitalism's fault? And how much of that is really government's fault? I can tell you, it was government's fault. You had local, state, and the federal government enacting laws that artificially restricted the job supply in these areas. Of course, you would need to move under these circumstances. Yet, in a free market, the only limit on employment is supply and demand. If the supply of workers is higher than the demand, then the likelihood of finding employment is low. So if the supply is low and the demand is high, one could find work with ease.
That rate of moving was way higher than in most European countries. And that central struggle, unifying and organizing a disparate working class, was made more difficult by a lot of other problems. Another source of division was occupation. Early attempts to form unifying working class organizations across different levels of skill, like the Knights of Labor in the 1880s, were destroyed by state terror and repression.
You know, sometimes I'm surprised. Is she really going to admit that the state is responsible for the repression of unions and not capitalism?
There were also cultural and political distinctions that made building a party of the working class impossible. The fact that America had universal or near universal male suffrage at a relatively early date, decades before the United Kingdom, prevented voters from polarizing on class lines.
Class lines? Oh, you mean the poor versus the rich? So it's near universal suffrage that stunted socialism. Well, at least she didn't say capitalism.
That's part of why, in the 19th and 20th centuries, many of the most dedicated socialists in America were Europeans importing socialist traditions from their home countries. It's no surprise that socialism tended to be strongest in immigrant communities, among Germans, Scandinavians, and Finns in the Midwest, and among Jewish immigrants in New York.
Now it's immigrants? It's like whack-a-mole. You knock one down, and another one pops up in its place. First, Marx and Engels, an American socialist, opposed near open immigration. They regarded it as a cancer on workers' solidarity. Union membership, for example, was lower when immigration was open. In fact, the amount of socialists among immigrants was limited. Germans, Finns, and Scandinavians were the main demographic of socialists among immigrants. Oh, and also Terence Powderly, the leader of the Knights of Labor, endorsed a ban on French-Canadian migration. So yeah, nice shooting yourself in the foot.
And all of these difficulties in building a broad-reaching socialist coalition were compounded by the structure of American politics. Even today, think about how many times you've seen a friend on social media begging people not to vote third party because it will take away votes from another candidate. And this difficulty was made worse by the brutal repression of socialists. Violence by state troops and private police forces against unions in the 19th and 20th centuries.
If you're referring to the Pinkertons in the Homestead Strike, nice try. The strike was the effort of an armed mob. In one incident, the strikers opened fire on the Pinkertons on July 6, when the barges of the Pinkertons tried to cross the river. The rioters were not prompted. It was not self-defense. They shot on the Pinkertons first.
The first Red Scare of 1919 to 1920, which saw many radicals jailed or deported, and then the second Red Scare of the 1950s, which saw socialists and communists blacklisted and fired. Even now, people who consider themselves communists are banned from immigrating to the United States. But the question isn't really why America never became a socialist country. After all, neither did any of those European countries. The real question is why, after the Democratic Party briefly became a social democratic party in the 1930s and 40s, America has been without any party pushing not just socialism, but any sort of redistribution to help ordinary people.
What are you talking about? Justice Democrats? The new progressive movement? Oh, in the 1960s expansion of the welfare state? This is so aggravating. They ignore basic reality.
That is the most bizarre absent feature of America. But of course, history isn't destiny. Denied opportunity their whole lives, forced into dead-end jobs, facing mountains of debt and grim prospects, more and more Americans, especially young ones, are identifying as socialists.
Being duped into an ideology which on a mathematical level cannot work reliably. Also, who created the debt? Is it the state inflating the currency, stealing our wealth, and spending in excess? No, that would go way over your head.
This is Emma Biglin for the Gravel Institute.
So you admit it, it's not about social democracy, it's about socialism. Otherwise, you would have said it's about implementing social democracy. However, you say it's about implementing socialism. Nice.
Socialism never took root in America before, but that doesn't mean it can't now.
I'm sorry, guys. That was so painful. I need to make an appointment with my doc, because I think this thing has literally given me brain cancer. It's that stupid. Hey, guys, I hope you liked the video. Please share it around and subscribe. Have a video for me to debunk? Please comment down below. Have a wonderful day, everyone.